Hello and welcome. My name is Daria Kolarczyk and I'm representing AVSystem's marketing team. Before we start, I would like to kindly ask you to use the chat option on the right side of the panel for entering any questions you may have. We will be doing our best to answer them at the end of the presentation. We will also be sharing the recording of the webinar as well as the slide deck. And without further ado, let me officially start today's webinar by introducing the speaker, Marcin Nagy, Product Director for IoT at AVSystem. Marcin, over to you.
Thank you, Daria. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening from Krakow, Poland. Well, let me start with the company introduction. For those of you who doesn't know us, we're the Polish company specializing in building device management systems for telecommunication operators and IoT enterprises. This is the list of our selected customers. This is not a full list of our customers since it doesn't include some of our Fortune 500 companies, including AT&T and SoftBank among them. Let's just go straight into the topic and let's start with the basics. We have an IoT device that is reporting temperature and to an IoT server. And imagine that the device is reporting such an information. There is identifier of the device, there is a value, and there is a timestamp of this measurement. The question is if this is something that we can trust. And the answer is no, since there are multiple problems in this setup. First of all, there are adversaries in the network. And these network adversaries are able to read, modify, or fake network communication. But this is not all, since there are also malwares that can be installed on the devices. And these malware are capable of extracting secrets, changing state of the device, or even modifying behavior of a device. So based on these two aspects, we argue that there is a need for secure communication channel and for malware protection. And these two topics is the main agenda of our webinar today. We'll be focusing solely on these two problems and how to address them in the IoT world. So in terms of secure communication channel, what are the requirements? First of all, there is a need for the mutual authentication. What does it mean, mutual authentication? And this mutual is the keyword here, is the keyword in the IoT world. This means that both parties, device and the server, need to be authenticated. And this is a big difference in comparison to the web or internet world that we know. In majority of use cases, the client device does not need to be authenticated. In IoT world, there is such a requirement because we are meeting the virtual world is meeting the physical world. This means that our actual thing, actual device, this can be any device, this can be thermometer, but this can be also a power plant, is connected to the network. So it is a requirement that if there is a command that is being sent from the server, it has to be sent to the right device entity. It is not acceptable that any device masquerades for a different device. And example of problems that can arise in this area are, for example, Stuxnet, a very famous malware that destroyed Iranian nuclear program. We can see what are the potential effects if this requirement is not met. And Stuxnet was just an example from the industry, but we can also think about our daily tools that we are using, healthcare equipment, for example, insulin pump. If a wrong command, including regarding the dose of the insulin is sent, it can be really lethal for a person suffering for diabetes. The second aspect is about integrity protected. This means that the message that is sent from the device to the server cannot be modified on the way. And finally, confidentiality, it is also a very important requirement. It may not be strictly required always, since there can be use cases where the information can be shared between the device and the server does not have confidentiality requirements. However, it's important to talk about it and consider it as well. So let us now start with the transport layer security protocol in IoT. This is TLS, the word we know. And TLS comprises two parts. There is a TLS handshake protocol and then TLS data. In the handshake protocol, the first part is about the negotiation, handshake negotiation. During this part, device and server authenticate each other, exchange keys and negotiate the session key. They are also exchanging information about supported cipher suits, version of the TLS that is being used, and then during this negotiation, they agree on the common language they are going to speak. After the negotiation part is over, both parties are sending this change cipher spec message. This means that when a device sends, it is an information for the server that after this point of time, all my communication to you is going to be protected, authenticated, and encrypted both. And the same message is being sent from the server. And the meaning of this message is the same. Authenticated and encrypted communication from me from that point on. And once the TLS handshake part is done, we can start sending the actual application data over the secure channel. I mentioned about this requirement of mutual authentication in IoT, and it is achieved by means of pre-shared keys that are shared between a device and the server. Here, the mechanism for sharing this pre-shared key is out of band. It's not part of the TLS specification, or through a certificate that is being embedded or inserted into a device. If we are talking about IoT, it is also very important to talk about energy optimizations, since IoT devices are operating in very constrained environments and are usually also constrained devices. One of these optimizations is called TLS session resumption. This means that if a TLS session is lost, there is no secure channel between the device and the server. There is a way for sort of lightweight handshake, and the session can be resumed. The important the requirement for the resumption is that there has been already established a security context between a device and the server. And the second addition that is available since TLS version 1.3 is called zero run trip time handshake, zero RTT handshake. And there is a requirement that there has been pre-established a security context between the device and the server, possibly with pre-shared keys. And the real value of this optimization for IoT is that the less handshakes you have, the less this control information required for establishing secure connection is done, the lower energy usage we have, and the better battery lifetime. TLS and transport layer security is the most popular mechanism of protecting communication. However, it is important to understand that this may not be enough in some cases. If there are gateways or proxies, which are very popular in IoT networks, the TLS or DTLS sessions are being terminated on these gateways, and then they are reestablished. So imagine a situation when there is a malware installed on an IoT gateway. Your communication from your device to a gateway is secured. There is no problem. However, if that session is terminated, the message gets the information, the security context gets broken, and it needs to be reestablished by the gateway further to the server. If there is a malware installed, malware has the potential to subvert this communication. It can act as sort of a man in the middle, and you have no guarantees that the information that is sent from the device is the actual information that is reaching the server. The answer to this problem is end-to-end security on the application layer. For example, this can be achieved using the OSCOR protocol, which we are going to describe later. The idea here is that message within the DTLS session is encrypted by the key that is shared between device and the server. And at the point of termination of the DTLS session on the IoT gateway, the information within the message is not accessible to a gateway process and potentially the malware that is being run on the gateway. The second problem constraint with the transport layer security is that it works within IP network on top of the TCP IP stack. However, as we are in IoT and we talk a lot about energy optimizations, non-IP networks are also becoming quite popular. If non-IP networks are in use, there is the TLS IP headers are stripped from the message, and it's just a pure message that is being inserted into the network. If this is the case, then there is a need for link layer security to be established between the communicating parties. I mentioned OSCOR as a way of end-to-end security. It is a quite new IETF standard, and it was defined as a CoAP extension. In terms of security features, it provides encryption, protection, integrity, but it also has a way to prevent replay attacks, and it binds requests to the response to avoid attacks where response to another request is being sent. The key distribution mechanism is a pre-shared at the moment. However, there is being currently work done in IETF in terms of establishing a lightweight key exchange protocol. The important feature of OSCOR is partial message encryption. This means that not the full message needs to be encrypted, but only important fields. It has two advantages. First of all, the less you encrypt, there is a lower burden on the encryption process, which means less CPU cycles and better energy results. However, it is also useful for the use cases with IoT gateways, where there is a need for doing some processing on the message and information that is needed by the gateway to make some processing is exposed to the gateway. This means that the gateway functionality can be achieved without compromising on the message security. And another side effect of this is that generally the overhead of the message is very small, which also means that if you transmit little overhead in terms of bytes on an air interface, this means that your radio time is not so much longer than without it. So this does not contribute to a larger energy consumption. And since this is working on an application layer, and application layer is completely separate from the transport layer, this solution is applicable also in non-IP environments. So to sum it up, we have transport layer, application layer, and also link layer solutions. Transport layer is the only solution that requires presence of an IP stack. Other solutions can work in the non-IP networks. In terms of protection type, transport layer can offer end-to-end security if there is a direct connection between a device and the server. However, if there is a proxy or gateway on the way, we cannot enjoy the luxury of end-to-end encryption, end-to-end security. Application layer, OSCOR, for example, is type of an end-to-end security. However, link layer mechanism is only hop by hop. This means information is secured only during the communication on two subsequent hops, and the security context needs to be established between subsequent hops. If we talk about non-IP networks in IoT context, it is not such a big deal since the device is talking over the air interface to usually a telecommunication operator, CEF, which is trusted. So there is a protection of communication between the device and the and the operator. And then from the operator to the server, there is, again, a trusted channel established. So there is a hop-by-hop protection on every of this hop. And since the SCAF is believed to be the trusted, then the risk of lack of end-to-end encryption is very low. And if we talk about the examples for the transport layer, we have MTLS, MDTLS. On the application, we have OSCOR. And on the link layer, we can talk about LTE security mechanism. And for example, if we talk about communicating over the satellite, we can have some satellite specific security mechanisms as well. If we talk now about practical aspects of the mutual DTLS, first of all, it's important to remember that there are plenty of open source libraries that are available. The most popular is OpenSSL. For the more embedded devices, there is an embed TLS implementation. There are also other implementations available, for example, tiny DTLS and so on. The biggest challenge with this DTLS or TLS is authentication of a device. Since that's why we keep repeating about this M letter, like mutual DTLS, mutual TLS. And the challenge here is how to enroll a device with a proper authentication secret. The secret has to be also, you know, enrolled on the server, but since there are far less servers than the devices, there are dedicated ops teams responsible for maintaining security of the servers, providing certificates, and so on. This is not such a big challenge. The challenge is with the devices. And if we look at the most popular solutions for MQTT protocol provided by Microsoft Azure and AWS, there is a device authentication mechanism ready-made that is being provided using the certificates. In Azure, there is a dedicated service called DPS, Device Provisioning Service. And device, before is connected to an IoT hub, has to go through the DPS in order to be provisioned with the proper certificate that is being then enrolled on the device. And the same, not same, but very similar mechanism is provided by the AWS as part of this AWS Device Provisioning Service that is part of the IoT core services in AWS. In AVSystem, we are a lightweight machine-to-machine standard believer. So our products are not supporting at the moment MQTT. We are supporting lightweight machine-to-machine. And as part of lightweight machine-to-machine, there is a different standard that, practically speaking, is probably very similar to what AWS or Microsoft Azure is offering. It's called Enrollment over Secure Transport, EST. And it is a mechanism for supporting secure certificate enrollment or a device on the device, but also re-enrollment in case that the certificate on device is about to expire. And what is very important in IoT is that this is a scalable solution. This means if you think about thousands, tens of thousands of devices, this really scales well. Devices can implement logic in which they understand when their certificates are about to expire. So they can initiate a communication with the server in order to get a new certificate. The idea behind it is very simple. The device, if first of all, it needs to download the trust chain of the certificates it is going to trust while connecting to an IoT server. So it sends the CI certificate request and the server is responding with a trust chain. And then device is generating a public-private key pair that it is going to use for the communication. And the public key, together with the identity of the device, is used for together. And then these two items are signed by the private key of the device. And this is forming certificate signing request message. This is going to be sent to the EST server. And then EST server, after properly validating the device, meaning that it is allowed to get the proper certificate, is requesting the device certificate from the certificate authority that is part of the EST. There is not this communication between EST server and EST CA is not defined by the standard. It's something that can be completely custom. And upon generation of the certificate, the server receives it and then sends it back to the device. And device can store this certificate, which it can use for further communication with IoT servers. And EST is working well with HTTP. So for devices using HTTP, that was part of its initial offering. And generally, EST was not a big success when it was first standardized around 8 years ago. But it has found its very popular use case in IoT, and it was very easily adapted to using CoAP for communication instead of HTTP. And there is a ready-made open source implementation of an EST server provided by OpenXPKI. You are interested in, so please we encourage to try it. There are also commercial products that are offering this. For example, there is a Finnish company called Labat that is offering these services. In terms of the second problem that we mentioned here, we talk about malware protection. And what were the business motivations behind the requirement for the malware protection? It all started with the mobile devices in the 90s. Telecommunication operators wanted to have a mechanism that are going to be tamper resistant for the changes of IMEI numbers and for having mechanism for securing storage licenses for radio frequencies. Then it created sort of some hardware security mechanisms for storing this that made it difficult to access, but it was only provided by the device vendors. Then the second step was the question, if there are device vendors are using this, can operating systems mobile phone vendors can also use it. And this is when it was extended towards credentials protection. And finally, when you know both of these parties were involved, then the third parties in this picture was third-party applications. And there was the need for protection of very sensitive data within application. And this all called for the hardware security mechanisms. What are hardware security mechanisms? These are pieces of hardware that provide isolated execution environment, protected storage, and very importantly, in talking about malwares, ability to convince remote verifiers that they are actually entities that we are willing to communicate with. This means that if a server is connecting with a client, or if part of your application is talking to part of this other trusted application that we are going to define in the next slide, you have the guarantee thanks to the remote attestation functionality that the code was not tampered, the code was not changed by the malware, and the code running there can be trusted. And there has been multiple solutions for this. It started with the crypto cards from IBM. There has been trusted platform modules. And most recently, well, maybe not so recently, it's been like 15 years ago, ARM introduced Trust Zone. So going into more details, what are these trusted execution environments? The most important thing to understand here is that there is a hardware separation of execution environments. There is a rich execution environment on the left of this picture, and this is the normal operating system that we know, together with the applications that are running there. And then this rich execution environment is separated by a different hardware from the trusted execution environment. And if the applications can be communicating between this normal rich world and the secure world using the instruction, the microprocessor, microcontroller instruction defined by the hardware vendors. So the main idea here is that when application running in the rich world wants to invoke a trusted application in the running in the trusted environment. It calls the functional API of a TE, and then this, this API is calling the SMC instruction, which is called secure monitor call. And this means that there is a full context switch from the rich world into this trusted world. This means that the execution of the software of your of the software is the context is completely switched, and from now on only the application, the trusted application is running. Trusted application has access to all data on your device. However, in the rich world mode, you cannot be trusting, you cannot be accessing information contained within the trusted part of your system. Important aspect of this is that there is this secure startup functionality. This means that when there is a boot of the system, the trusted OS is booted first, and all applications before being booted are checked if there have not been tampered. Every application that is being submitted to the trusted execution environment is being signed by the trusted party, and then the trusted OS during the boot is verifying the signatures. If the signatures aren't matching, then the application is not started. This is the way to guarantee that only code that has been authorized by the author can be run within the trusted execution environment. In terms of secure environment context switch, means that if the SMC instruction is being called, there is a the information in the trusted execution environment, the CPU information, state of the registers, and so on, are all going to be encrypted and inaccessible from the rich world and the other way around. There is a way for providing remote management for the trusted applications. This means that if you have first version of the application and you want to change it for the next version of the application because you have a new functionality and so on, there is a way to do it using the over-the-air interfaces. And there is also a way to securely store your information. This means that whatever you write in the trusted application is going to be stored either within the trusted hardware part of your device, or it's going to be encrypted with a specific key that is not accessible beyond the trusted part in the part that it can be reached by anyone. In terms of the architecture, there are three main architectures. One is the on the left one is the one that has external security coprocessor. This means that the whole the execution is being done on a completely separated hardware part, physically separated hardware part. And it is the most performant. It's the most performant architecture since both the normal world and the secure world are not sharing anything, and both of them can be operating in the same time. The other one is the second one is with the if the security coprocessor is embedded within the same hardware parts, and in this one it's only one or another. So it can be either the normal CPU running or the embedded security coprocessor. And this means that when there is a context switch between these two worlds, all the registers and flashes and memories need to, need to, need to be flashed. And the third one on the right, which is the one provided by the ARM Trustzone, for example, is based on the idea that every physical core in the CPU may have multiple virtual cores, and then the trusted part is being separated on the virtual level of the same. So there is the same physical physical CPU. However, there are multiple virtual virtual cores within the same CPU, and this is the way to separate them. And the same is for the RAM, ROM, and all the other necessary components. Let's now see how this can be used in practice. So we talked about credentials, we talked about EST, so let's see how this can be used in practice. First of all, imagine you, we have a normal application. This can be an IoT client, and it wants to communicate with an IoT server. So the first thing it does, it's asking for a key pair generation so that there is a public and private key for the communication that is needed for the establishing of the secure channel. So to do this, we have to remember that the private key should never ever leave a device, because otherwise it can be compromised. So to protect the key, the private key should always reside within the trusted part of the application. So in the normal world, we are invoking the T client to call the trusted application that is going to generate the key pair. The key pair is generated. The application flow is coming back to the normal application. And the next step is the normal application is asking for the generation of the CSR, certificate signing request. The signing request is being signed by the private key. Again, so the private key, this operation needs to be done within the trusted world. So context is switched to the trusted world. CSR is being generated. It's returning to the normal world. Once this is done, we are sending the CSR as part of the EST diagram that we have seen before to an EST server. The EST server is doing validation, generating certificate for us. Certificate is being sent back. And then the device wants to protect the information about the certificate so that it's not easily stolen and used by someone else to impersonate a device. So after receiving the certificate, again, trusted part of the system is being invoked and the certificate is being written to the trusted part. And then when we are communicating with an IoT server, we are using crypto library, for example, embed TLS, and then we need to provide the device certificate for the communication. So the crypto library is going to ask, please get me the certificate for the communication. And we are reading this certificate always from the trusted part. Okay, so what can we say about development of these TE applications? Historically, TEs were very closed systems. I mentioned that in history, it was in the beginning, this was just device vendors, then mobile phone vendors, TE vendors, and so on. They had access to it, and they decided what can be really executed. These barriers were broken, and then there was more openness for using TE. The biggest problem was that there were no really development tools. They were very cumbersome, expensive. Nobody really wanted to do it. But the last 10 years, we have seen a vast increase in TEs. There is a standardization body called Global Platform that has standardized interfaces for TE. And based on this, we also have now the open source tools that allow any developer to simply build TE applications, OpTE and OpenTE, for example, among them. It's a way to build your trusted application in software, making sure you can build them, you can test them, make sure that they are fitting the requirements for running in the trusted hardware. And once you are happy, you can easily try to compile them on the trusted hardware and see how they are working. And it has been for a long time believed that TE is unbreakable. However, in the last 2 years, there has been proven attacks against the security of the hardware. So basically, it cannot be taken for granted anymore. There has been proven existing software attacks and side channel attacks. And there needs to be a way in order, you know, to mitigate these problems. One way is to try to prevent the compromise of TE. One way to do it is formal verify the code. The easiest way is just to use libraries, use part of the code that has been verified using some static analysis and so on to be believed to be safe and without major bugs, security bugs. And the second aspect is to try to minimize the coupling of TE and RE, rich execution environment. If you remember the pictures about the architecture a couple slides ago, then the more physical separation there is between TE and RE, the lower are the chances of getting compromised. And the second thing is that if you are not able to prevent, then you need to have a way to tolerate it. And then you can think about having some redundancy in your application and having make means that are application specific. One can think about it if you are running some, there was a couple of years ago, the trend, we don't need to run any cryptographic operations anymore if we were running our code within TE, because TE is unbreakable. So if then what could be the result? If your TE is compromised and you don't have any cryptographic security mechanisms involved, then the attacker can extract whole information from you. However, you can also do it this way, use TE, but if TE is broken, develop your application so that there is a cryptography, there are cryptographic mechanisms as a second line of defense. And it also has to be mentioned that in the recent year, the vendors of TE had also started providing more hardware extensions to avoid potential software attacks. Among them, there is authentication of pointers and memory tagging extension. There are many, many more. If you are interested in understanding the potential security problems that have been discovered recently, please go to this Black Hat paper from 2019. And as a conclusion of this, we would say that please use TE if you can. It's always good. It's adding another layer of security, but be ready to assume that it can fail at any point. And if it fails, you have to have another mechanisms to avoid being totally compromised. And one more initiative that we want to talk today is about IoT Safe. We mentioned about TE and hardware security module, and IoT Safe is another hardware security module. This is part of the GSMA standard. And in this standard, the SIM card is being used as the hardware security module. The credentials are being stored on a SIM card, and there is an operating system running on the SIM card and IoT security applet, which is implementing cryptographic operations. And device is communicating with the SIM card using the AT commands. And since there are SIM cards, there is a way to communicate in SIM cards with the telecommunication operators. There is an easy way to provide remote credentials to the devices and manage these credentials remotely. So finally, after talking all of this security mechanisms that we have, we would like to just briefly mention Anjay, our lightweight machine-to-machine SDK. We have support from lightweight version 1.0 and 1.1. And what we are also providing support for non-IP network environments, for EST, for TE, and for OSCOR. We are partnering with many chipset vendors. We provide full-blown integrations for various embedded and non-embedded as well operating systems. OMA treats us as the reference lightweight machine-to-machine client implementation. We have been selected 6 times in a row as one of the top lightweight machine-to-machine client during the OMA Test Fest events. And our Anjay client is offered in 2 versions. One is the open source version readily available from the GitHub, or there is a commercial version. Anjay lightweight machine-to-machine is one part. On the other side, on the server side, we are also offering the Coiote, which is the lightweight machine-to-machine based server for device management. It provides the functionality of the complete IoT lifecycle management. Similarly to Anjay, both versions of lightweight machine-to-machine are supported, and we also provide support for NIDD and EST. We are able to provide functionality at scale with clustering, load balancing, and geo-redundancy. Similarly to Anjay, we had scored top in lightweight machine-to-machine server OMA test vests. And at the moment, we are concentrating in building tools for IoT ops. So not only device management, but means for providing jobs for people for IoT ops teams. And then as the last product that we want to talk about is Coiote Data Orchestration. This is sort of an application enablement platform behind residing behind the Coiote DM. More than 10 deployments at the moment. We provide flexible and fully customizable user interface, very well integrated with the device management platform. And it's a tool, basically, it's a tool for data enrichment for doing business process management. Thank you very much. Thank you for your time. And I'm happy to listen to your questions. So the first question, will the slides for this webinar be made available as a PDF file? Yes, they are going to be. Then the second question, with EST, how the device can download the trust chain securely, given that it doesn't have a trust chain to begin with? Well, there has to be some leap of trust. So you have to trust your EST server to begin with. And then this trust has to be established in the first place. Then the next question is OSCOR used only for resource constrained devices. Can you use OSCOR in high bandwidth networks and for devices with high computing power? There are no limitations to this. Since OSCOR is being designed as an extension to CoAP, and CoAP has a very good interoperability with HTTP, you can use it as well together with HTTP. How is the next question? How is the initial cert? Okay, the T requires a trust chain or not? Yes, it requires a trust chain. And the next question: how is the next question is EST over CoAP supported by most certification authorities? Frankly speaking, I don't know the answer to this. I know that there are a couple of commercial products available, but I don't know how widely it is supported. Coiote DM is supporting EST over CoAP. And the next question, with regards to slide 17, does eSIM with ESE architecture ensure similar security in 5G IoT deployments? Need to refer the GSMA SAS security mechanisms, the HSM-based IoT deployments? Yes, the question is yes, it's the same. eSIM is also can also be part of this, eSIM and iSIM and normal SIM. The next question, I think in this architecture, the challenge is who to trust. Yes, I think the problem is always about some leap of trust, or it's probably an unsolved problem. I would say that there is this fragment in the book by Stephen Hawking about the brief history of time. He is referencing to a lecture that was supposedly given by Bertrand Russell, talking about the universe and the place of Earth in the universe. And suddenly, an old lady is standing up and saying this is all false because there is the Earth is flat, and it's being placed on the tortoise. And then the lecturer is asking, and what is the tortoise sitting on? And then the old lady says, you are a very smart person. So what's the conclusion out of this? It means that, you know, that there is always some root of trust needed. Always and everywhere. And I believe this is a problem that cannot be solved even at all. The next question, SIM card includes eSIM communication integration. I believe this is in the context of the IoT safe. And if it's in the context of IoT safe, yes. The next question, the devices in the network need to run on lightweight machine to machine. I don't understand this question fully, since you can run any protocol you wish to run. You can run MQTT, you can run lightweight, you can run pure CoAP. It's up to the implementation. And the mechanisms that we are describing here, the TE, EST, and so on, are protocol agnostic. The next question, are the EST server credentials required to validate the initial signing request? Yes. If so, does this mean that these credentials must be passed to the IoT device and that the consumer must trust the manufacturer with the credentials of the EST server? Yes, this has to be added in the, to begin with.
Marcin, thank you. I believe there's one question towards the beginning that we missed. Would like to understand the difference in security mechanisms suggested by AV systems versus PKI and APN-based security some of the vendors are proposing?
I would like to understand the difference in security mechanisms suggested by AV system versus PKI and APN-based. Right, so we, for example, if we're talking about AV system and PKI, we are using PKI internally. For TLS, there are certificates. Certificates are being signed by the PKI. So PKI is just the component that is a must in order to build a robust security systems. And APN-based security, I believe here we talk about the link layer protection mechanisms. So this is very important if we are operating within the non-IP networks or other. APN is non-IP networks for this. Well, communicating with the APNs, you can protect yourself with a transport layer. But if you are doing this in the non-IP way, then you have to protect yourself with the link layer security mechanisms.
One that we also missed, I think, is does OSCOR provide a lower security level compared to DTLS and or TLS?
Can you repeat it? Sorry.
Does OSCOR provide a lower security level compared to DTLS and or TLS?
No, I don't think so. I think you cannot be comparing these two because they are operating on different layers. Both of these, you know, in the end, it's about cryptography. Cryptography is about block ciphers these days, symmetric block ciphers and asymmetric cryptography for key distribution. And OSCOR, we have the pre-shared key between both parties, and there are block ciphers used. And the same is for TLS. It's just different layers of operation. And TLS is always terminated by the gateway or a proxy. So if your gateway or a proxy is being compromised by malware, then you risk that your message is insecure. And for OSCOR, there is a guarantee of this end-to-end security. However, you have to remember that transport layer security is probably easier since it has been with us for a long time. There are ready-made libraries. You don't have so much of a development effort. If you are going for application layer security, there is just more that you have to do, more effort that you have to do in order to achieve it. But I always say end-to-end security is always better. Wouldn't it make more sense to use a one-time passphrase like SCEP for the initial signing request instead of trusting the IoT device with the EST server credentials? Wouldn't it make more sense to use a one-time passphrase like? So here is also important to understand that device is not provided with the EST server credential during the manufacturing phase. It can be configured later. So in the example of integration of EST together with lightweight machine to machine, the device is manufactured with the account and credentials to the lightweight machine to machine bootstrap server. And from that bootstrap server, it can be redirected to an EST server. I think we exhausted list of questions.
I hope so too. In any case, if we did not get to your question, we will respond to you via email. And if you have any more questions, please also feel free to reach out either to AVSystem or to Marcin directly.
Yes, we'll be happy to answer all of them.
Okay. So many thanks for joining us today. Thank you very much, Marcin.
Thank you. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Bye-bye.